Synopsis of the Books of the Bible. 2 Samuel. By JN Darby. All scripture is given by inspiration of God. And is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness. That the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works. 2 Timothy 3 verses 16 and 17. Synopsis of the Books of the Bible. By John Nelson Darby. 2 Samuel, chapter 24. The sin of numbering the people. 2 Samuel 24 leads us into a subject which requires particular notice. The wrath of God is kindled again against Israel. It is not in the mind of the Spirit to inform us on what occasion this took place, but to lay open God's dealings both in government and grace. In the preceding chapter, God writes up the mighty men who prefigure the companions of the true David in glory. Here it is his grace in staying his anger and bringing in his blessing. God's dealings in government and grace. God punishes the pride and rebellion of Israel by leaving them to the consequences of the impulse of David's natural heart. Job's habitual cleverness and good sense made him perceive its folly. The flesh, when it is in another, is easily discerned. Job felt that it was not worthwhile to despise God when nothing was to be gained by it, for in this way the flesh fears God. But the thing was of Jehovah, and Satan gains his point. When in truth can man's good sense avail in opposition to the will of God in chastening, and to Satan's malice? It is an awful thing to be given up to his power. 9 months of sin on David's part, and of patience on God's part, show us the fatal influence of the enemy. But the sin accomplished only awakens David's conscience. The enjoyment of the fruit of our sin undeceives us. It is the pursuit of it which allures our hearts. When Satan has succeeded in inducing the children of God to commit the evil to which he tempts them, he cares no longer to conceal from them its emptiness and folly. Happily, where there is life, conscience resumes its power in such a case. David's choice, his confidence in God. Nevertheless, chastening must follow sin which has been carried out in spite of so much long suffering. But God, who reaches his servant's conscience, brings into play the sincere affections of his heart, in order to bring about his own sovereign purpose. David exhibits that never failing token of a heart that knows the Lord, confidence in God above all, and at whatever cost. Let me fall into the hand of Jehovah. Sweet and precious thought of what the Lord is unto his people. And well he knows how to fill the heart with the certainty that he deserves its confidence. Even while chastening, God is more loving, more faithful, more worthy of confidence than any other. The plague breaks out, but in the midst of judgment Jehovah remembers mercy, and commands the destroying angel when he had reached Jerusalem, to stay his hand. It is Jerusalem, the city of his affections, that attracts his attention. God chooses it for the place where his altar shall be built, and his grace shown forth, his appointed mercy seat. It is there that his wrath, justly kindled against Israel, ceases, and sin gives occasion to the establishment of the place and of the work in which he and his people shall meet, according to that grace which has put away the sin. This characterizes the cross of Christ, this will stay the plague in Israel, and introduce the reign of the true Prince of Peace. David stands in the breach to deliver the people, and at his own cost, verse 17, and, typically according to the counsels of God, he offers the sacrifice of appeasement. The altar at Araunah's threshing floor, the atoning sacrifice. The thoughts on the first book of Chronicles will contain a fuller examination into this latter part of David's history. But it is a striking close to this book, after all the governmental history of David, that it closes with the atoning sacrifice which stops the wrath through grace and lays the foundation of the meeting place of God with Israel and the place of their worship.